One. Hello and welcome to the latest DJ Mag Panels event. And today we're joined by a very special guest, Mr. Norman J, MBE. Give him a clap, you horrible beat. Norman's a legendary DJ who started off doing warehouse parties and carnival sound systems. One of the first DJs on Kiss when it was still a pirate. Was influential in the rare groove and acid jazz scenes and became synonymous with Notting Hill Carnival with his Good Times sound system. We're going to hear all about this, about all of this and more, so stay tuned. So Norman, what first got you into DJing in the first place?
Well, I guess I got into DJing by default. I was a serial club goer, almost fanatical record buyer when funds allowed, and just a lover of black music of nearly all kinds, reggae through jazz through soul, through R&B, and then my evolution continued into the 80s, 90s, noughties, etc. And my interest in homegrown music began to grow around the same time. So I loved, the first generation early UK hip hop. I loved the first generation early acid jazz and house. And when my contemporaries began to go into studios and begin to make their own music. So I've loved it all, really, truly.
Can you remember the first DJ gig you ever did?
The first, it's a question I've been asked many times, and the older I get, the more it becomes a faded, distant memory. But I think one of my earliest recollections of playing music would have been when I was around 9, maybe 10 years old, playing at my older cousin Anne's birthday party. I was the only one in the family that had records, because I was buying records from when I was about 8 or 9. And Anne suggested that get Norman to play the record because he's got records. Not because they were any good, but I was the only one that could work the record player, and I was the only one that had records.
From there, how did you end up DJing at warehouse parties like your Shake and Finger Pop ones in the 80s?
Well, yeah, it was a long road. I guess subconsciously, by the time I reached my teens, I probably was harbouring latent DJ tendencies, though I didn't know. It wasn't a conscious thing. I hated the DJs. For years I went to clubs. I never went anywhere near the DJ booth. Was always near the speakers, so I was only interested in what was coming out of the speakers rather than who was playing what. My love of certain types of music decreed that I went more frequently to some places than I did to others. My love of Northern Soul began in the 70s. My love of music from Philadelphia began then. I was in a position financially, I guess, with the help of my parents and a paper round, I was getting like 10 shillings a week. That's 50p to you, today's money. All my time and money was spent buying records. And I got to credit my parents, particularly my dad, who always encouraged us, because he realized, at a very young age, if your son or your daughter find something that really interests them, the thing to do, if you can, is nurture it. Don't force them to do something that they really don't naturally gravitate towards. Even though my dad bought a secondhand piano when we were kids, we always had a musical instrument in the house. We had the piano. My brothers and I never went anywhere near it, but my sisters learned to play this out-of-tune piano that was always there. But my interest focused on my dad's prized and very expensive at the time stereo radiogram. Not the traditional German blue spot or Blaupunkt that everyone had. With the help of higher purchase, which then became available to the ordinary working man, my dad invested in a top of the range Bush radiogram, which is probably one of the first stereo radiograms in the country. He bought that in 1960. still have it today, and it still works. Yeah.
So when you first started DJing out, what sort of music were you playing?
My initial interest and in first records I bought were sort of reggae, ska, blue beat, Motown records, chart records, all the stuff that you heard on the radio that the record shops would stock, the regular record shops. But I was very fortunate, you know, living in West London, living in Acton and commuting between Acton and Notting Hill, Latimer, almost every day, I would have to go through Shepherd's Bush. And in the late 60s, Shepherd's Bush Market was blessed with three, maybe four top reggae shops within the space of, you know, 100, 150 meters. So, needless to say, all my Saturdays would be spent between those four shops, even though I had no money to speak of. You know, I avidly followed all the latest releases, used to watch when the import guy would come from the van with all the latest sort of Trojan and ska and reggae. And it was really frustrating being probably, you know, 10, 11 year old and not being in a position to buy it. And that used to take up most of my Saturdays. I'd go there with a couple of mates of mine. And on Sundays, the following day, after all the bigger kids had been to the parties on the Saturday night, I vividly recall that they would bring some of those records over to the park the next day and play them on a little dance set while everybody played football. And the funny thing was that in those days, battery technology was crap. So was speaker technology crap. I'm talking late 60s now. Within half an hour, the records would begin to slow down on the dance set. So the bigger kids would come round and mug us all for our change and then make us go and buy the batteries to keep the record player going. So, yeah, that's my earliest recollection of that. But to answer your point more specifically, I really didn't harbour any intentions to become a DJ. In those days, the DJ was actually the loser. He was the one that never got to enjoy the party, you know, never got to get the girls, never got to become the life and soul of the party. You know, if you drew the short straw, right, you're the DJ, which meant that you observed everybody else having a great time. I spent many years being unfamous or not being recognized, but you know, I was happy. I was an enthusiastic amateur. I'd hold major birthday parties at my mom's house. And we used to have massive family gatherings every birthday, every Christmas. There'd be an awful lot of people crammed into my mom and dad's house. Speakers would be hooked up, and music would be blaring until the early hours. And it was normal. You know, or you know, ask or talk to any Afro-Caribbean family at that time, you know, one simply didn't have the resources to go out paying to go partying and dancing. You kept the dance in your house.
So when at the warehouse parties in the
warehouse parties would come a good few years later. Probably my first public gig would have been 1978, 79 at the time, probably 79. You know, we'd just put together the rudiments of a sound system. You know, my brother Joey had built, you know, Great Tribulation as a roots reggae sound system, as it was back then. He'd built that since 1974. And for 4 or 5 years, you know, I'd go and help him, go and support him, as we all did in those days, at the local sound clashes, whether they be in a school or... more often than not, someone's house, an old house, church building, you know, something like that. And then by 79, I'd already saved enough money to go to New York for the first time, care of Freddie Laker. You know, Freddie's airline has provided the ordinary working class man with the opportunity to go to America for like £99 return. Can you believe that? So having known that I had family on my dad's side who was living in New York and Philadelphia, it was like a mecca to me. It was somewhere that I always wanted to go, but America was always a place as a black man that scared me. I was terrified of America. You know, I'm old enough to remember when Martin Luther King was assassinated. You know, I'm old enough to remember when JFK was assassinated, and then his brother Bobby. And you know, I'm a black working class, you know, kid born in England, growing up in England in the 60s, and I can vividly remember in 1968 the then Tory MP for Wolverhampton, Enoch Powell, made his infamous Rivers of Blood speech. You can look that up on the internet. And that's when I became aware of the racism and the oppression that, you know, people of color were going through in this country. But that was magnified by a factor of 10 to what was going on in America at the time. I vividly remember the riots in Watts in Chicago when it was burning on the south side, turning on the TV, even though the UK TV companies used to try and, you know, censor it, you know, hose pipes being turned on blacks, and, you know, and I followed the whole civil rights thing. And in that era, I literally grew up. Muhammad Ali at that time was my big idol. And I was, I guess, on a constant search for, you know, black icons, role models, you know, positive ones. And then I discovered James Brown. And then everything changed. even though I loved all the Motown, all the sing-along, happy songs. But, you know, along came someone like Brown who was commentating on, you know, on black civil rights movement. You know, and I'm of that age where that resonates with me in a big way. So I start to look for more of these records, which I learned years later on that the British government tried to ban the imports of these records because they feared black insurrection round about that time, because America was burning and they feared the same thing might happen to London or Birmingham or Liverpool. But anyway, you know, I'm buying these records, I'm listening to the message, hearing the message big time, but at the same time, loving all the current music that was coming out. So I naturally gravitated towards the funk, which then evolved into disco. I lived through the whole disco era, loved it. I found myself in New York in 1979, going to a couple of block parties 3 years before that art form became known as hip hop. So I was in New York, in Queens and South Bronx at the time when hip hop was being born. And I instantly knew that was the future, you know, with the whole electro thing. Cause I can remember coming back from New York that summer after having spent a couple of months at my aunt's, you know, who lived in Brooklyn, coming back, coming to Notting Hill Carnival with a box of records this big, brand new, you know, New York disco, electro, and coming to Carnival and trying to play that stuff to a crowd who were essentially reggae, soca and black traditional music lovers, but they weren't having any of that. So I had a proper baptism of fire in those days. So 79 and 80 would probably be around that time. I was doing a few house parties, which got bigger and bigger and became more and more popular. And then by 1985, I'd done my first warehouse party, where just on strength of word of mouth, I think we attracted between 2,500 to 3,000 people.
Were they quite wild, those warehouse parties?
Not wild in the way one might describe a rave, because it was full of cool people. They were actually so cool, we never had the need for security. Bring your own drink, make a donation if you want. So it was mainly kind of counterculture kids like myself. We didn't swim in the mainstream. This was the proper underground, because my playlists would be right across the board of everything I loved. On the surface, when I was doing my good times thing, it's all the tunes that you know and you love. But my alter ego was Shake and Finger Pop, which meant, you know, as a black DJ, an unknown black DJ, I could play music off-piste that people would never credit you for liking, much less playing, or knowing anything about. So yeah, I played punk records that I liked, I played rock records that I liked. And obviously the cream of the best black music that was out at the time. And my narrative was about educating the crowds in front of me of the history of our music from a black DJ's perspective, which had never been done before.
Why did you change the name of your and Jay's sound system then from Great Tribulation?
Well, we changed the name. It's up until that time, Joey was using the sound system for the Sound Clashes. It's a traditional sort of roots reggae, lovers rock sound system. And it was called Great Tribulation because he went through Great Tribulation building it. You know, building it in the snow. I can remember him, cutting and sawing and soldering and screwing in the worst weathers. No money, no resources. It was real make, do, and mend. You know, anyone who's throwing out an old television, right, we'll have the speakers. You know, anyone who's throwing out an old radiogram, right, yeah, we'll take the turntable, we'll take the belt drive. You know, and he became, a self-taught, sound engineer, basically. So, yeah, when he was using the sound system, and I came back from New York, 79, I was sheiks all over the place, absolutely massive. This is at the height of Paradise Garage, not the Paradise Garage, Studio 54, which I'm actually glad I never actually got inside to, but I never wanted to go in. I used to stand outside there with the crowds, hundreds of people thronging, watching, and they used to have little tannoys, so you could hear the music that was being played. And to my ears, that music was crap. And I weren't going to pay the dollars or go through all of that to try and get in there. At the same time, I was fully aware of David Mancuso doing his parties. At the same time, I never got to go to them because I didn't know him personally. But my cousin Terry used to go to them all the time. You know, he was part of that in crowd. So I was fully aware of them, and Terry would say, yeah, well, David's playing this, Norman, do you know this? Yeah, I'm playing that, but, you know, my crowds are not with it. My crowds are at home. We're not schooled in those sort of tracks. We've got a different take and a different taste. So by 79, I'm harboring plans or intentions to make my debut at Carnival. I chickened out in 79 because we weren't ready. So all year, this thing sat in my head, we're going to go back next year, Joey, 1980, we'll be ready, a year to prepare. So borrowed my dad's old Cortina, we put two boxes, an amp in the back, and we drove up, in those days you could, on a Friday night in the rain, and we sat up outside a house on Cambridge Gardens. The only reason we sat up there, because I'd done a little reconnaissance a few days before, found out it was a squat that some travellers were squatting. And I asked if we could get power, because in those days, that's what determined whether you played at Carnival or not. If you could secure your power source, you could rock up and play. And because I was a bit, more diligent, I'd done a recce on my homework, and I think for a couple of cases of lager, the guy goes, you can plug in, stay as long as you want. So we did. August Bank Holiday weekend, 1980, we made our debut. Good Times was born at Carnival.
And how was those first 10 years at Carnival?
First 10 years, well, we haven't got all night, but it was fraught. A lot of violence in those days, proper Wild West, no regulation, no curfew. You think Carnival's bad now? I lived through the worst days of it. Because Carnival for us used to start Friday lunchtime and finish on Tuesday lunchtime. Not like now, it's it's Sunday, midday Sunday to 7 o'clock on Monday. I'm actually glad that they've got the curfews and all that in place. It restored some semblance of order in the chaos. But we were there on Cambridge Gardens. Basically gave us 10 years to hone our skills, learn our craft, learn how to entertain crowds. And in 1989, Carnival expanded north. And I was the first to put my hands up in that meeting with them, with the organisers, going, yeah, we'll move. Because I really wanted to get out of ours.
Why did you want to move then?
Because of the violence. I just wasn't, it was either that, either we move or I was going to stop doing it. And a lot of my friends in Clubland, in London Clubland, just wouldn't come. I knew a lot of people. I had a lot of friends. a lot of, as we called, faint hearts in those days, but you couldn't blame them. You know, we were in the epicenter of carnival, which, for what I was trying to do, just really wasn't working. So 1990, we moved north, probably half a mile as the crow flies, to the place where probably all you guys recognize Notting Hill, Good Times at Carnival now. We moved north to Southern Row, West Row, when nobody was there. We were the first sound system in that entire area. And I've just come out of a carnival meeting, because the carnival offices used to be the top of the Hapney steps on the top of Ladbroke Grove. And I'd lost the original spot that I wanted to move into, which was in the car park in Sainsbury's. Mastermind had already poached that one first, because they had first pick, because they were senior to us, because they'd been doing carnival before us. And I was absolutely gutted when I came out of that meeting, stormed down the stairs. What am I going to do? I was in a real quandary, and I walked down the Hapney steps, and I walked along Southern Row, and I stopped there. And then I had an epiphany moment. I looked around and thought, this is absolutely perfect. And I remember when I was telling my brother, Joey, he's like, oh, Norman, have you lost your mind? Nobody will come there. Joey, trust me, within 5 years, we will have this corner rammed. We did it in three. And
so it wasn't quite rammed at first, but it very quickly was.
Because people needed to find out. It was a huge transition. You know, people are creatures of habit. If they, no matter how many times you told them, how many flyers you give them, we're not in Cambridge Gardens anymore, we've gone up to Southern Row. Hundreds of people would still turn up at Cambridge Gardens. And then I'd see them in the following weeks, and they go, where were you? You know where we were, we've moved. So I said to everybody, it's going to take between 3 and 5 years before everyone gets the message. Good Times at Southern West Row, that's where you'll find.
And in the 80s as well, you were involved in the formation of KISS, which was a pirate radio station at first, wasn't it?
Yeah, I was one of the founder members of KISS FM, actually, along with Gordon Mack, Tosca Jackson, and George Power. Yeah, I'm one of the four founding fathers of
it. And why did you want to get involved in that at the time?
Because I understood the importance of people like myself having access to the airwaves. I mean, it doesn't matter how many clubs you play in, there's only so many people you can reach. And I know that if you really want records to reach a wide audience, if you really want records to break, whether they're brand new records or really old records that you're trying to resurrect, the only platform open to you is radio. You know, we weren't ready to make that leap to television. The television thing is the most tightly controlled and governed. There's no way the British media were going to let, you know, a bunch of kids, you know, jump onto that platform. So they kind of tolerated you on the radio, provided there was no profanity, provided there was no politics. We used to have a little thing up in the studio, no swearing, no politics, simply music. And most of the DJs adhered to that.
And you stayed with KISS for quite a long time, didn't you?
Only in the early years. We started KISS in the summer of 1985. I guess I spent about 5-6 years there, because we came off air for a year twice.
To try and go legal.
Two amnesties. The government said first time around, if you come off air for a year, we will consider your license application. And we at KISS dutifully did that, only to be effed over by them. The government and the powers that be, Home Office, reneged on that. So within weeks, just like every other pirate, we came back on air again. Then in 1988 or 89, can't remember the exact year, they were a bit more serious. Home Office said, well, we're offering you another amnesty. And if you abide by that amnesty, we will give your next application serious consideration. So the more sensible amongst us said, yeah, we'll comply. The more rebels in our camp at the time is going, no, Norman, it's a contract. They're going to mug us off again. No, but luckily we prevailed, Gordon Mack and myself. So we came off air and we submitted the application. And to our astonishment, in 89, we were granted legal status. So on the 1st of September 1990, Gordon and I hosted the first ever show of legalized Kiss FM. And then within 6 months, I'd left. And for me, it was mission accomplished. I'd done what I set out to do. And I really, you know, I was always into newer, other challenges. You know, my whole life has been littered with the fact that I've always quit when I'm at the top of something. If you're going to go, that's the only time to go. So, yeah, I left Kiss when it was absolutely peaking. Job done. And I went off to do other things.
Can you clear this up once and for all? Was it you who came up with the term rare groove?
Absolutely. Yeah, of course, because my show was called the original Rare Groove Show in 1985. And my dear late sister... got a whole loft full of the original Rare Groove Shows on C120 CDKs.
What did you think when house music first came along? Did you like it?
I loved house music even before it came popular. Like a few of us at the time, our audiences weren't ready for it yet. You know, the dichotomy was for me, you know, the Rare Groove thing in London in the mid to late 80s was all conquering. And that during that same period, every summer for 2, maybe 3 months, I'm in New York, going to the Paradise Garage, going to Nell's, going to Circus. Getting to know players that everybody knows and loves. House music, they weren't even known. Most of them hadn't been outside of America. They didn't even know. You know, another thing I'm going to credit myself with is that, you know, I was, along with Danny Rampling, because we did it together, we brought the first American DJ to play in the UK at my club back in 1988. I did a club called High on Hope at Dingwalls with my then promoter partner, Patrick Lilly. Based on the Paradise Garage model. It was mixed gay, mainly black and Latino, and we were playing all of that music a full year before it became into the clubland mainstream. I had people like Louis Vega play there for me when Louis was in the crowd, and bless Louis, because to this day he still credits me with that. You know, I saw him in the crowd. I just bought a record. No one knew who he was, but I knew him from New York. I pulled him out of the crowd as I was playing his tune. I stopped the music and I told 600 people in Dingwalls that night, this guy is absolutely amazing. You're going to be loving his records. And then, within a year, you know them as Masters at Work. Real risk. I used to go to the Jersey Jams talent show 4 or 5 years on the trot at Tony Humphrey's club. His name was it? I can't remember where it was. A shelter, Zanzibar. That's right. It was a Zanzibar Sunday night. Club was amazing, but getting away from it safely was another story. I go to the Zanzibar one night. For the final of the talent competition, there's about 1,000 people in there. 99.99% are black. There's 2 white faces standing at the side of the booth. I thought, boy, they must be brave to come in here. And I walked down, and this guy turns around. It's Danny Rampling. It's like, whoa, wicked Danny. He was there with his then girlfriend, Jenny. That night, we watched Blaze win the talent show. And we looked at each other and we go, we've got to bring this guy to London. So we worked out a deal with Tony Humphreys. Tony didn't even have a passport in those days, never been out of America. So I persuaded him to come and do a Thursday night at High on Hope at my place and do Danny's club, Shum, when it was at the fitness center, because Shum was you know, the most happening house music club in London at the time. It's the mother of all acid house clubs, as it became known. So Danny and I shared the cost of bringing Tony to the UK, and this would have been either 1987 or 88. Can't remember the exact year. May even have been 89.
Were you down with the more noisy sort of acid house stuff that came along?
No, I was originally. I loved all the original Detroit techno, all the DJ International stuff. Now I was buying that stuff since 1984, thanks to a DJ called Jazzy M, who first he was one of the first people in the UK to import those records. You know, these were records that one or two of them I'd previously heard on visits to Chicago, thinking, where's this music come from? Why can't I get it? It was scary, it was dark, it was intense. I loved it. I just loved it. But, you know, I'm enjoying all of that stuff when I go to New York and I go to Chicago. And when I come back, I've got to play Alexander O'Neill records and Luther Vandross records, which I still love. Because I loved all elements of it. I loved this because it's new, it's exciting. I knew it was the future. But I didn't know it was going to make the impact it did. I thought nothing could top hip-hop. But house music, in terms of club land playlists, it did. It still didn't trump hip-hop because hip-hop had a live element and sold billions of records, which house music never has, and to this day probably never will.
But then shortly after you were involved in setting up Talking Loud, the record label with Giles Peterson.
Yeah.
And a label that became synonymous with the acid jazz.
Yeah. So. Well, Giles and I seemed to have the magic touch by then, because we were headhunted by Polygram, a giant useless record company like Polygram, to come in there and start a cool, trendy label for them. So Giles and I go in there. We'd never done record company jobs before. We're like, wow. We go to A&R meetings with rock A&R guys, got no understanding of our sort of music. And to be fair, we had no understanding of what they were about. But we knew that, you know, these were dealing with the big guitar bands that sold millions, and we were starting from scratch. So Charles and I very quickly came to a decision that we will spend our meager budget on our friends. Put our friends in the studio, because when I got the A&R gig there, I had all these guys from the hood coming with there, some of them with crap demos. Come on, Norman, help a brother out. You're in a position of power now. I'm like, yeah, but this is shit. I've got this girl. She can really my mum sings. You want to hear a singer? Hear my sister. My sister's not off. You know, there is all that, but looking back on it, you couldn't really blame them because, you know, I was, at that time, the most senior-placed black A&R man in the whole of the UK record industry. So there was a tremendous weight on my shoulders. I felt under a lot of pressure. And I thought, I'm not going to go through this circus of listening to demos and seeing people and pushy managers trying to... No. I looked inwards for all... I come from there. I've got loads of friends who are great DJs, aspiring musicians. Let's give the money to them. Get them in, get them demoing. So, you know, I was seen as the godfather of a group of West London musicians, singers, DJs, producers, you know, from which we got the Brand New Heavies, from which Jamiroquai came from which, you know, all the sort of Talking Loud stroke acid jazz. We were a little clique of people and making great records. They were never going to sell millions, but they were cool records still. So we put those guys, we demoed them up, you know, Young Disciples, Galliano, you know, I knew Omar, you know, who was making great records and doing great live shows. So I signed all of them. We signed all of them. And within 6 months, you know, we had our first top 10 record. With Incognito, with Always There, with the Young Disciples, Apparently Nothing, Mother, all in the same year. We're like, whoa! But all that did was put pressure on us. You know, our bosses were going, we need more of this stuff. And then on the other side, all our artists are going, we're not pop stars. We don't want to be doing this pop stuff. We want to make proper music and do proper shows. So we're caught in the middle of all of this, being caught between the loyalty of our friends and the music that we really loved and wanted to make. And on the other hand, as we've been often reminded, it is the music business. It should be called the business music or the business record, because it is business first. They invest money, record companies invest money in you, not as a favor, not because you're a great artist. You know, it's a risk that they front up the money and you make them back money with bells on and with interest. It's simple, because I used to say to kids that used to come see me as an A&R man, yeah, this is great. And you think I'm being a wanker for not listening to you? Then take your demo to Barclays Bank. Take your demo to the Nationwide. Go and see the money manager there. And if he invests in that, you come and see me, I'll give you double. It's financial gamble. You know, the money supports the art. And in the end, the art has to make the money. If that equation doesn't work, then you best stay as an enthusiastic amateur, because it's not going to happen. As record companies in America quickly reminded me when I used to go over there to do business with them, how many records are you going to sell? Very interested in the artist.
The bottom line.
How much money? The bottom line. How much money is this going to make me? If you can't answer that, you best leave the studio.
So this was another thing where you sort of quit while you were ahead.
Yeah, absolutely. No, I mean, I loved my years. I had five great, brilliant years at Talking Loud, working with Giles and the team. I absolutely, truly loved it. I mean, the legacy of that, you know, still goes on today. You know, great British hip-hop, great British R&B, great British soul, great British jazz, our homegrown music. And then latterly, as the kids got their heads around the electronic age, we're making fantastic house, garage, techno records.
Drum and bass.
Well, yeah, another story. I love the fact that, you know, all of those genres would never, America would never have given us those. You know, America gives us and has given us the DNA. They've given us jazz, they've given us blues, given us soul, given us gospel. And the great thing I love about Britain is that we've adopted it. We're always very early adopters, but we fuck with it.
Put a twist on it.
We twist it, we ruin it, we muck about with it, we play. We're not frightened to experiment. Okay, 99% of those experiments may be crap, but when one works, it's a game changer. It moves the music on another level. You know, acid house could only have come from England, you know, or the UK. Drum and bass could only have come from the UK. Just like grime, a mutated form of hip-hop. That could only come from here, you know, our sufferation, our misery. Just like genuine hip-hop, you know, when it was social commentary hip-hop, you know, in the late 80s and 90s, my favorite era of hip-hop, what they called the middle school from 87 to 93. You know, the Daisy Age stuff and the social commentary, not the gangster big dick crap, I'm talking about the social commentary stuff. You know, that's when the music was its most creative, and incidentally, that's when it sold the most. But, you know, British music is great, and we've come a long way from that now, that technology has been the greatest leveler. You know, technology has made the music scene really democratic. So great music and crap music now comes from all corners of the globe. I don't really care of the color of the skin of the person who's made it, where they come from. You know, that's a good thing. Great music now comes from all over the world.
So in the latter part of the 90s, you were still DJing and doing the carnival thing, and you started a regular session at the Big Chill Festival, didn't you, where it became like a tradition where you'd had the legendary 3 p.m. Sunday afternoon set.
Yeah.
Every year, and this became like an institution.
Well, that started quite by accident. I think it was Katrina and Pete, these are the people that ran the Big Chill. I was doing a mini festival in Sydney, Australia. Would have been probably about 91, 92, which has become legendary in Sydney, Australian clubbing folklore. This gig was called, something on a summer's day, Vibes on a Summer's Day. I did the very first Vibes when there was about 50 people sat on that beach hut right by Sydney, right by on Bondi Beach there. And by the second year, there was like 2,000 people there. Or by the third year, there was about 2,000 people there, and I would do the headline set. And fortunately for me, that year, Pete from the Big Chill was there. We didn't know each other, and it's a great way for someone to discover what you do. And at the end, he came out and said, "That's the most amazing thing, Norman. I run the Big Chill in England." I said, "Yeah, I've heard of it. I'd love you to come and play." And I said to him, "Well, I was a bit apprehensive at first because the Big Chill, by its name in those days, everybody was lying down, sitting down. It was just a lazy fest of kind of left field electronic experimental noodly music, which I didn't want to go there and do that." And I thought, well, maybe my eclectic style isn't necessarily going to work. So I played at the first one down in Lama Tree, and it was idyllic, you know, on a farm. There's chickens running around, and pheasants. It was just like, and everyone was just lying down there because I was playing the slowest music, you know. I was playing soul and listening stuff. And then about half an hour before the end of the set on a gorgeous Sunday afternoon, I sensed that people wanted to get up. So I picked up the mic and I said, "Listen, do me a favor, stand up." You know, like a teacher, I just took control of the situation. "Everybody get up, come on." And everybody, they got up. So I instinctively changed the music, put on something quite fast and funky. And the place went mad. I thought, "Oh, great." And Pete said, "Well, we're leaving Lama Tree, we're going up to Hereford. We'd love you to continue to stay." And I said, "Yeah, I would, on condition I'm not doing I can't do a Saturday because I wanted to do house music on Saturdays." I said, "I'll do a Sunday afternoon for you, and that way there's no pressure on me to make people dance, because by Sundays, traditionally, people were already going on their way home. So only the people who really wanted to hear you will stay. So there's no pressure on me." I thought, "Oh, great." And I used to call it like you know, the oral aspirin session, you know, the recovery, because I knew what people felt like, because they'd caned it the night before, and Sunday people are just rolling up, "Oh, my head, oh, the hangover," people are lying there. And it became legendary, you know. Funny enough, I only played dance records for the last two or three records, but everybody, because, you know, it was great, that platform. You know, I played music that I truly loved, but had never played anywhere else before. I played Hendrix, Jimi Hendrix, 25,000 people on the main stage. You know, I played Dizzy Rascal. You know, I played David Bowie, all the stuff that I liked. I'm not just a black music fan. You know, I love great folk. You know, I like great guitars. I like great songs from great artists. You know, I play Elton John. They're not guilty pleasures to me. These are blokes who are top of their craft, who've made the best records the world has ever heard. And I'm never going to be churlish or shy. I think, "Oh, I can't play that." There's no such thing as can't play. There's only won't play. If you create the moment, any music works. You know, I know. I made a career out of it. You know, I made records work that should never work. And, you know, at the same time, I've made some big mistakes, played the wrong records at the wrong time. But, you know, experience teaches you. You do that so you can learn from it.
When you got the call about getting an MBE, what did you think initially?
Well, I thought that was a game show hoax. I said, "No, I'm not appearing. I don't want to be on this program. Take your game and go away." Not knowing that I had less than 48 hours to formally accept or refuse it. So this time I'm working at BBC London doing my Sunday show, and when head of programming, you know, this was a mythical figure. I didn't even know my BBC producer there, and he calls me when I'm on tour. I'm doing a gig, I think it was in Scandinavia somewhere, Sweden or Denmark or somewhere.
I get a call from him like 5 o'clock in the morning, thinking, the F's calling me at this hour, I've just got in. I normally have just been trying to reach you, Buckingham Palace have been on. And I knew coming from him, this was no hoax, because he doesn't know me well enough to. And he said that they've been trying to get hold of you. And I said, well, give him my mum's number. I wasn't going to give him my mobile. Give him my mum's number and tell the palace to ring up. So when I get back that Monday, my mum calls me. So I've had someone from Buckingham Palace come, and they gave me a code, and you're to ring the Prime Minister's office. But I know you can't muck about with that. If you've got this code, it gives you direct access into number 10. So I rang, put in this code, and I get through. Norma Jett, yes, oh, we've been desperately trying to reach you. You've only got a few hours, but you've been awarded an MBE. I'm like, what? That was so far off my radar. I didn't know. But she said, you've just got to formally accept it, so we'll send you the telegram, and you'll get it by the morning. And sure enough, telegram comes with the Royal Seal. That's when I knew it was real, because you can't fake the Royal Seal. I got this letter with the Royal Monogram Seal on it. I opened it. Wow, you've been awarded an MBE. Do you formally accept this? I'm like, sure do. Went straight back, and then 6 months later, I was at the palace getting my award from the Queen.
And you were the first Black British DJ to get an MBE, weren't you? What did that recognition mean to you?
It meant an awful lot. It meant an awful lot, not just to myself and my family and friends, to the wider community and all people in clubland, you know. And I've before that, I'd never won polls or won prizes or won any kind of accolades for being involved in dance music.
Been in the on the cover of DJ.
Yeah. And actually, that was the first cover I ever got. I'm very proud of that still. DJ Magazine's always supported me, and I'm eternally grateful for that. But this was the highest accolade one could ever get. This supersedes anything that you'll ever get, any Grammy, any Golden Award, Globe or whatever. No, when the monarch of your country, personally acknowledges, your contribution, your efforts for the field of work you're in, no one comes bigger.
Did it sort of open any extra doors for you?
It could have done. If I was that way inclined, yeah, I could have done. The only thing that I did was made sure I added it to my passport, because believe me, it really works. And your phone calls got returned, and people have to take you seriously. I mean, they don't need to. I mean, the running joke at the time was the only people that had to address me as Sir were Gooners. Being a Tottenham fan, I insisted that all Gooners, you call me Sir, and you bow. But now, joking aside, no, it's a terrific honour, because it opened the door for my contemporaries and my peers to be acknowledged for their work as well. I mean, subsequently, Trevor Nelson, Jazzy B, Pete Tong,
Goldie,
yeah. So yeah, it's great to be a sort of a trailblazer. And the other thing I'm especially pleased with, I'm the only one that ever got it from the Queen. Yeah.
So what, with being a Spurs fan, what is it with Spurs playing at Wembley? They just can't seem to.
Oh, don't even go there with that one. The season hasn't begun. Let's just put that season. I'll take a rain check with that one. I'll come back when the new season, when the new ground opens. And hopefully, if the club are listening, I want to be involved in the opening stadium celebrations. I hear rumour, and it's just rumour, that they're thinking of getting Adele. You know, she would fill the place anyway, because Adele's a lifelong Tottenham fan. But if they need a DJ, throwing my hat in the ring, Norman Jay's lifelong, and I want to do it.
You must have a fair selection of hats at home. Do you know how many you've got, your funky hats?
Well, it's just like the records. I've never been interested in counting them. It's meaningless counting them. My wife Jane is a trained hat maker. Just one of several of her creative skills, and she makes my hats or adapts them. I love hats. I've had a lifelong love affair with hats, and I think you're not properly dressed unless you're wearing one.
Oh, thanks.
Present company accepted, of course.
Have you still got any of your chopper bikes? I remember one time you rocked up at Homelands or Creamfields on one of your chopper bikes.
Yeah, I did. You're right. Boy, your memory's good. It was... I still own a fairly substantial collection of bikes. I have done. I don't buy or collect them now. I haven't done for years. But yes, it's true. I've owned a collection of rally choppers. I still love them. And within the next year or so, I'll definitely be having a fire sale. The knees are a bit knackered a bit now, so it's a bit difficult getting out on them. I still ride. But I definitely want to auction one or two with all the money going to charities or organisations that are close to my heart. So watch this space.
So with Carnival, you did it for many years, since 1980, obviously, and then just lately you've kind of stepped away. How come?
Well, we haven't got all day or all night, and I don't really want to pontificate on that point too much. Suffice to say that 2013 was the last year that I played there. I knew it was going to be my last year, but I couldn't find it within myself to tell the crowd that I wouldn't be coming back. I just wanted to keep all my options open, because I knew 4, maybe 5 years before that area was possibly going to be regenerated and we'd lose the site there. So in that meantime, I tried desperately to search or locate or secure somewhere that was at the very least, equally as good. But there's nothing in the whole of the area around Carnival time that came close to Southern Row. That's why I went there. It was sad. It was hard. Telling people, I'll see you next year, knowing full well we weren't coming back. And then in subsequent years, I'd been back and realised it was the right decision. Carnival was costing an absolute fortune to do, because most people who go don't know, don't care, or are not aware of the fact that Carnival only runs because every participant, whether it's the floats, the soaker, or the sound system, that is all financed by us, with no way of us being able to recoup that financial outlay because of the council and the police restrictions. I know that because Good Times was only one of 3 sound systems in the whole of the Notting Hill Carnival that was allowed to run a legal bar. The council wouldn't grant licenses to anybody else, and we only got ours because under the old council rules, because I'd been there so long and had one or two friends in there, I applied and we got one. But subsequently, all the other sound systems couldn't. You can't perform on a public highway, whether you're a band or a sound system or anything, unless you have public liability insurance. And for 99.9% of the sound systems and the floats and other things there, no insurance company will touch us because of what Carnival's like. Carnival, the premiums were like hundreds, and in cases, thousands of pounds. And when everyone is turning up to Carnival for free, we're already operating, a huge financial loss, which was totally unsustainable. I was one of the lucky ones. For 7 good years, I managed to secure sponsorship from Budweiser, and not Budweiser in the UK, Budweiser America, the parent company in the States, was financing me, only because one of the chief executive's wives came to Carnival one year, loved what we were doing. And then when I, was looking for sponsorship from various companies, meeting ad agencies, meeting blue chip brands, my name was flagged up. Is that the same guy, Norman J. from Good Times? Yeah, we'd like to help him. So I went to America, met them, and was signed a 2-year deal, which rolled into 7 good years. It's through that funding I was able to get a specially adapted bus, build a proper stage, create a massive sound system, get banners made, pay our insurance, pay all the taxes, pay everything that was due. Yeah, we were lucky. Only about two or three sound systems were in the same position as us, Sancho being one. But then, you know, as the instances of violences and the negative publicity in Carnival increased, your premiums just shot up. Remember, if you needed to hire gear for that, you have to pay a premium because it's a three-weekend hire, and you have to prove you've insured that gear for that weekend to go to Notting Hill Carnival. And when you will rock up for free and then enjoy it all for free, there is a cost. And we always have to bear that cost. So in that 2013, with all of those things stacked against us, time to call it a day.
You've got a new compilation about to come out, haven't you, called Mr. Good Times on Sunday Best.
Yeah.
Actually, for everyone here, you can... One of you can win a copy of everyone who's here, and
right.
People online as well. One of you can win a copy if you answer this probably quite easy question.
Go on then.
Which is, what was the name of the disco act who did the song Good Times, which Norman and his brother Joey named their sound system after? And for those of you online, we're going to pick out at random a winner from the correct answers, people dropping the comment in the Facebook chat. And for those of you here, who's the first one who's going to put their hand up? What's the answer?
All right. Give it to
you. Well, that's no good. Well, Norman, can you briefly tell us a little bit about the comp?
Yeah, I'm extremely pleased with the contents of the comp. I've loved doing compilations. If I had my way, if I ruled the world, I'd do a compilation two or three times a year. I love compiling and curating various artists' compilations. Though in recent years, the bottom has kind of dropped out of compilation markets, but that's purely because the record companies saw fit to do it themselves. They were curating them themselves, or basically by random computer. You know, they own all the catalogues of all the backdated stuff. So they were very happy because it doesn't cost them anything. It's cheap. You know, if you own the Motown back catalogue, you can be chucking out a Motown compilation every week of the same old songs, you know, and no credibility is attached to it because there's no story that goes with it. The thing I like about compilations, however they manifest themselves, is that the curator, more often than not, has an affinity with the music, you know, a history. He can put it in context, you know. He can, or she can, you know, give anecdotes about how or why, you know, why they love it, where they heard it, who played it. You know, there's all of that, but, you know, the big major label compilations, they're quite sterile. You know, they're MP3s, there's no love.
There's a lot of love in this.
Yeah, I've loved putting that together. I initially start with a wish list of about 60, 70 tracks, and for various reasons, sometimes through cost, sometimes through ongoing legal situations between the writers or the performers, you know, there's disputes over who owns tracks, who still needs royalties from them. So a lot of tracks, for various reasons, become unavailable. So you submit 60-odd tracks, and you're lucky if you get 20 back. And sometimes it might not be the 20 or 30 that you really, really wanted. And on occasion previously, I have said, no, this album can't go out. I'm not happy with the tracks. Because the album I really wanted to make, the tracks for whatever reason have been knocked back. But happily with this one, I can honestly, hand on heart, say I absolutely love it. All of the tracks are the ones I was hoping that we'd clear. And Sunday Best record staff have been brilliant in clearing this stuff. And I've got to credit the photographer who took that shot. My old mate, long-time old mod, fantastic photographer, who's done that for me. So the whole package is it's great. It's something I'm proud of and happy to put my name to.
We're going to have an exclusive for the people who are here at DJ Mag HQ. We're going to have an exclusive first album playback in a minute or two after we've just got time for one question from the floor.
Right. Oh, right. Yeah. Right. Yeah. It's not my favourite stage down there. Suffice to say, I've told my management I don't ever want to play down there again. but, you know, it's great because where it's located in Glastonbury, you really have to make the effort to get across the whole site to find there, and the fact that you guys made it there,
it's the freaky field, isn't it?
Yeah, and the dust and the smells there drive me crazy, but the sound system was good, and I played because you guys were there, and it meant that the less people there was there, the more freedom I had with the music. There was no need to drive a dance floor, so to speak. Didn't need to play crowd pleasing stuff, so I could be quite self-indulgent. Only to the point where I need sometimes to be self-indulgent to keep myself interested, keep myself challenged, because there's hardly anybody there. But there was a few people there, and yeah, I remember that. Yeah, it was great. Mm.
Has anyone else got a quick question for Norma before we wrap it up?
I've got one. Hmm. Do you have a memorable DJ set that you played? So
Loads. That's a tough one. I could give you a different gig. You know, I love all the gigs that I play, and in my later years as a DJ, I've found that the crowd that I play to really trust me, give me a lot of love, and it might appear that I'm being self-indulgent, but I'm not. You know, as a professional DJ, you know, it's incumbent upon me to please the people in front of me with whatever music it takes to do that, and I'm happy to do that. You know, I guess in my attitude, I'm pretty old school, because I will try something. If it's not working, I will simply change it. I'll play something else. I'm not a slave to the beat, I'm not a slave to the rhythm. You know, if it needs to be changed, change it. You know, first rule of a DJ, I like to give to any aspiring DJs, make friends with your dance floor as quickly as possible.
Thanks to the wonders of the moment. We've got a question from Internet Land.
Interweb.
And it is, was the reaction to Le Fleur at Nottingham Carnival in 2010 the best reaction that you ever got?
It's right up there. I remember that because I was playing a house tune just before it, I think, and the sun came over. It was a burning hot afternoon. And it was, I think I just caught the zeitgeist at the moment with that. And directly after that house track, I put on that record, almost like divine intervention. I don't know, it was remote control, instinct. But I'm blessed with having the knack sometimes of playing the right music that captures the right moment. And I remember that. And yeah, that's one of the best reactions, but not the best. Probably the best reaction for a slow down-tempo track, certainly.
And you absolutely picked the moment, as all great DJs should.
Yeah, well, you know, my skill set is about selection. And I never claimed to be the world's greatest mixer or a serious scratcher, even though I love those art forms. I've never been someone who's been slave to technology. I'm very slow with technology. I'll only use it if it truly enhances for a moment what it is I do. But my core strength is knowledge and selection. That's one thing, you know, you can't unteach that. You know, I'm fortunate, I'm blessed. I still own virtually every record I've ever bought since 1967. And there's few out there that could equal that who are still doing that today. My love for it is every bit as strong as it was back then. You know, I remind people that I spent more years being unfamous and unpaid and mugged off than I have been famous and paid. But, you know, I wouldn't change a thing. You know, it's something I love doing. It's not a job. You know, one day I might pack up and walk away and go and drive a cab or do a proper job, you know, or go and help disabled kids. But until that moment, you know, I'm still going to continue to do what I love doing.
It's been wicked to hear about your life and good times, and look out for the compilation soon come on Sunday Best Records.
Yeah, it's been amazing. Thanks for having me.